Hello, and once again, welcome to Tech Terrain. Good to have you with us. I'm Tony Ndoro. Now, in this episode, we're going to be focusing on the small-scale farmer. How can they upscale? We'll talk about small-scale farmers in South Africa and throughout the continent, and also the bigger picture, the business of agriculture. And we've got a fantastic lineup for you today. We kick off the show with Wandile Sihlobo, Chief Economist at AgBiz. He'll shed some light on the state of the agri-sector on the continent. We'll then be joined by Langa Simela and Brenda Tlabani, who'll unpack some of the barriers to mechanization and look at some possible solutions for farmers. Also, stay tuned for a showcase of a new workhorse in the John Deere stable, the versatile 6B. So that's our strong lineup for today's show. Make sure you stay with us all the way through, and also go onto our website and make sure you catch all of that bonus material that we'll upload every single week that, of course, pertains to the agricultural sector and all of our Tech Terrain shows. Right, let's begin. So in this episode of Tech Terrain, we are focusing on Africa, the challenges of agriculture on the continent of Africa. And who better to talk to about this than the Chief Economist at Agriculture Business Chamber of South Africa, Wandile Sihlobo. Wandile, very, very good to have you with us. Let's talk about the state of agriculture on the continent first up.
Thanks, Tony. The state of agriculture in the continent, I mean, one can understand it in different ways. If you were to look over the past decade and say that has there been growth in agriculture in Africa, the answer there would certainly be yes. But that has not been widespread. There are certain countries that have seen much more progress. If you think of Zambia, you think of Kenya, you think of Tanzania, all of those in staple grains production, we've seen some bit of improvement. And obviously here at home, we've seen those improvements happening. But I think in the current moment of the COVID-19, this reached the African continent at a bad time. You had droughts before the pandemic, and you also had the locusts in East Africa. And as a result, we are having food insecurity problems.
You mentioned that growth, and you mentioned that it's been in your staple grains, which is something that we've always farmed all along the way, but there's been some calls to diversify that. Are those calls not being heeded?
Yeah, there is some bit of diversification. Soybeans is beginning, for example, to gain momentum in certain parts. Again, if you look at Zambia, that's where enormous growth in soybeans. But on the East Africa side as well, there's beginning to be some soybeans and sunflower development, Tanzania, Malawi. So that cause farmers are picking that up.
Okay, so in South Africa, we know there's large-scale farmers, a lot of commercial farmers. Talk to me about the small-scale farmers within Southern Africa. Let's talk about that. Is there growth in that sector? Are many people getting into farming and starting small?
Many people are already in the small-scale farming, but I think the hope for many for us and other and policymakers across the African continent is to say, how do we begin to commercialize these smallholder farmers? Because that's where we will begin to attain higher levels of productivity and the bigger yields. And I think that if you look again across the East Africa region, there's beginnings to be that many people are no longer farming a lot on a 1 hectare side. They're beginning to be between 10 and 20, and I think that is going to continue. And there's interesting work by Tom James and Lulama Trap at Renapri, which actually speaks to those developments that are happening.
Now, Wandile, for those small-scale farmers that you're talking about who may be farming on larger pieces of land, for them to upscale, they need to mechanize. Do they have access to a lot of that mechanism?
I think they do have access to the mechanization because you already have the agricultural machinery companies that are there in the African continent and the input suppliers. But I think what is different within the African continent compared to, say, to the United States, Europe, and South Africa is that the level of mechanization and the machinery that gets to be needed there, it tends to be different than the countries that are well advanced. But certainly they benefit from some of these technologies that are already there.
Okay, let's look at the large-scale farmers, the commercial farmers. Are they growing throughout the continent? We know South Africa is huge, got many large-scale farmers, and also their markets overseas. Do they have access to those markets, and are those markets growing?
Yeah, the commercial farming is growing, but I would say that it's not growing at the desired pace, which is why, for example, right now we are stuck with some of these food insecurity problems. Yes, it's part of the locusts, part of the droughts, but I think that had people been able to commercialize fast enough and have scale and be able to have strong access to all of the agrochemicals that are enjoyed by the countries that are well advanced, they would have been somewhat in a relatively better position that we're in. My hope is that past the pandemic, as development happens, people will begin to be open to some of these ideas and put more support into that.
When you talk about some of the developed countries, their governments seem they assist a lot when it comes to the agricultural sector. Are we seeing that same sort of assistance in terms of assisting with funding?
I think the assistance that in Africa can really be realistic is about making sure that there are conducive policy environments to allow investments to come in there. But if you think about the resource side, many of these countries are not fully resourced to be able to deploy that type of support that you find in the developed world.
Because, which puts us on a very bad footing because you can't compete there.
Competition, yes, becomes a challenge, but I think if you do have the technologies to really get the better yields, then you get to be in a relatively better position to compete.
Okay, so we're talking about getting the better yields when it comes to the African continent. Those are your large-scale farmers. Let's talk about the local markets, the African continent. Are we trading amongst ourselves when it comes to agricultural products?
I mean, intra-trade in Africa is somewhat growing now. If you're looking at what we are trading on imports of food, we import roughly around about $32 billion worth of agricultural products. Yeah. And if you see how much of that is actually through intra-trade, there's a big chunk of that. And even if you were to look at South Africa's agricultural exports, about 40% goes to the African continent. So that is improving, but obviously with the Continental Free Trade Agreement, we expect that to pretty much be at a better position in the coming years.
Are you positive that we're going to get on the right footing after the pandemic?
I think after the pandemic, it will be a state of rebuilding. That will take time, but I think that we should harness the energy that is already there.
Okay, fantastic. Good talking with you and some fantastic insights there, Wandile.
Thank you.
Well, plans are afoot at the moment to give small-scale farmers access to funding, access to mechanization on the African continent in South Africa. Coming up, I want to talk to two ladies who are very passionate about that particular subject. So earlier on, we looked at the African continent, the state of agriculture on the continent. Right now, I want to focus on South Africa, the financial options for small-scale farmers and some of the difficulties they face in that country when it comes to farming. To talk about that and to shed a bit more light on that, I've got Langa Simela and also Brenda Tlabane. Ladies, good to have you with us. Brenda, you're a commercial farmer. You came out of the ICT industry. Why did you do that to yourself?
I guess as a farmer, you have that conscious obligation to give back to those, the community that you're doing business in. I mean, I don't see how do I just have a full-scale production and while the neighboring community closer to where I'm farming are going to bed on hungry stomach. So you have to at least look into those aspects where you feed in the community, making sure that most people around you are at least guaranteed a meal to survive and sustain their livelihoods.
Okay, now we know from as a small-scale farmer, the biggest thing is finances to upscale. How did you do it?
That was the most painful process. I mean, just for starters, with the livestock when I started, it was a bit, you know, I was doing it in my own pace. But there came a time where the feed costs were too much for me in terms of buying bales here and there, leak. I had to find a permanent solution for me to keep my cattle. That's when the land issue started. I engaged Land Bank for financing of my first farm. That whole process took about 2 years just to be concluded. Those are things that are difficult for one when you don't really have a collateral. Maybe in my position it was better because I had some assets which I could at least put up to the bank to show that I was in a position to repay them. And that's how it started. It was a tedious 2-year process, but ultimately, after 2 years, yes, it was finally approved.
So Brenda, is there any financing or funding available at all for SMMEs?
Honestly, we don't have any. I mean, in the past, we used to have Land Bank, which would exclusively target the developing farmers at the stage where they would offer the support instruments. Right now, the Land Bank is operating in the similar terms as the commercial banks. And at a later stage, there was microfinancing option, which we used to call MAFISA, that would at least address some of the small-scale farmer needs. But that also has been recalled. That facility has also been recalled. So you end up having this unbalanced sector financing options in the sector where you have you don't have anything available in terms of supporting small-scale farmers and only have the instruments which addresses or which are more viable for the commercial range of farmers. So we don't have any bridge or that that addresses the that we don't have that there's a missing link or in between the financing option in the sector. So we don't have anything, and I think it's time that we start now talking about those things. We have spent so many years, I mean, trying to get government to say reinstate microfinancing option if you're not able to change the mandate of Land Bank, which would in the past address the developmental need for small-scale farmers.
So let me come to you, Langa. Coming from the banking sector, what are you guys doing to support small-scale farmers in South Africa?
We engage in partnerships. Maybe let me start with what the challenges we have to deal with are, and then I come to what we do to support them. A lot of the farmers, to Brenda's point, they don't have the collateral that is often required, you know, to be able to support these farmers. They have some technical expertise, but in a lot of instances, it's not well documented. So normally, you know, as financial institutions would rely on your track record.
Yeah.
Have you been receiving money? Have you been spending money? How have you been spending it? How much have you been generating to prove that, you know, your business is growing? And you find that in a lot of instances, your developing farmers are not able to provide that track record. So they cannot prove affordability. So those are the things that we sit with. One, it's a small scale farm. It's an economies of scale game. Can you load this machinery onto their, you know, onto their balance sheet and will they be able to pay for it? Do they have adequate technical expertise to actually, you know, keep up the cash flows that they projected?
I'm hearing what you're saying, and if you look at South Africa, most of those small-scale farmers are previously disadvantaged. We're talking about black farmers here, the collateral issue you're talking about. I mean, it's very difficult, which leaves them on in a lurch. I mean, then what after that?
So that's why I'm saying that I wanted to outline the problems to show where the problem starts. So what we try to do is to work in partnerships in order to be able to do that. So in terms of machinery, I mean, there's a certain level where the farmer would not be able to put it on their balance sheet. So what they can do then is to work with contractors, you know, who will then come and do the farm and make sure that they're growing, and then they're growing in their production. I'll give you an example. There is a company that we're working with. I'm not going to name them, but there are a dealership for tractors and equipment and so on. And they realize that for them to grow, you know, their market, they have to step into this developing farmer sector. So it's not going to be a business today, but it's going to be a business in the future. So what they're doing is they're partnering with us. We're growing these farmers. We're financing them. Yes, there's teething problems, but we're financing them. So they're going to be growing maybe from 100 hectares that they're doing now to 200 and so on. Then down the years, they will be able to afford the tractors. But where they are right now, they have to contract in and borrow.
Langa, the private banks, are they working in any way with government?
Yes, we are. We're currently working on developing this blended finance scheme. I know it's been in the pipeline, it's been coming for many years, but now there's a lot of traction going on in that, and the idea is to launch it by September, hopefully. But I mean, those are the partnerships that we need to finance the developing farmers. Private sector can't do it alone, neither can government do it by itself. So we need to form these partnerships and be able to support the developing farmers.
Langa, we've only got just a few more seconds left. I just want the last word from yourself, Brenda. What do you say about that partnership? Is it something that you think is conducive?
We yet to test that concept, because I don't think too many farmers are aware of it. Secondly, the criteria, what is it that they're gonna be doing? I mean, is it the same criteria of commercial bank where you're being assessed as in a commercial space when you're starting up. Is it viable for us? Is it an option for us? That still has to be tested. So I can't really give my full views on that because we haven't seen a lot of this partnership in the industry going on.
You're 100% correct. It seems like a catch 22 from my view. Brenda, well done for getting to the level that you've gotten. You're a livestock farmer, a mixed farmer at the present moment, commercial mixed farmer. So well done as well. And Langa, thank you so much for coming through. So throughout the show, we've been talking about small-scale farmers and farming in general on the African continent. It's now time to talk about the 6B tractor, which has been labeled by John Deere as a multi-tool. Here to tell me exactly why that is, I've got two gentlemen who know this tractor very well, Cobus to Toit, and also with me, Patrick Kubyana. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining me. Cobus, let me start with you. Why is this tractor called the multi-tool within John Deere?
Tony, thank you very much for the opportunity. It's a very, very wide statement to say it's the multi-tool, but we feel that in the 6B range, in that segment, it is a tractor that you need on each and every farm for each and every operation. That's why that segment lent to the fact that we can use it from planting, land preparation, in my feedlots, in my dairy yard, wherever you need this unit. You will be able to use it. And we've looked at that segment for very long, and we actually overlooked that segment for very long. And now with the entrance of the 6B, brilliant opportunity with the simplicity on this machine to go into the market and serve that customers as well with simplicity and brilliance.
Okay, now this particular 6B is very popular, not just with small-scale farmers, but with all the farmers. I want to talk about small-scale farmers. Why is this particularly attractive to them, Patrick?
For example, if you look at the 6B, it's a mid-spec tractor, and it's very versatile. And versatility, I mean, for example, if somebody is doing crop production, you can start with primary soil preparation, secondary soil preparation, you go to planting, you go to crop care, you can use it until the transportation side. So you see it fits on, irrespective of the size of the farm, you have a tractor that you can use. And if you don't do crop, for example, you're doing livestock, somebody who's doing livestock, he will probably do the feed. You need to cut your bales. You have a loader there that's attachable to the tractor. And you need to do your spreading of your fertilizers. You need to do the transportation. So this is very versatile, and it fits across the whole spectrum of farmers, irrespective of size and irrespective of practice, because there's always something to do for this tractor in the farm operation.
Tony, I can just link on to Patrick as well. He hit the nail on the head. The next segment as well that we can embrace on this piece is the farmer that's just moving out of that segment and start looking at contracting work. He most probably worked on 2 or 3 acres in the past, but now aspire to go that extra horsepower, that extra row on his planter, or create a little livestock farm or a feedlot on his facility, move him out of that smaller segment into the bigger segment, allow him access to that product range where you don't need all that particular technology at this stage, but just to get you through the process.
And one thing has been critical in this particular segment has got to be cost of ownership of this particular machine, Patrick.
Yes, obviously as a farmer, like it's a business. So margins are very important. It's important that you when you go into business, you should be able to make money. So the initial investment on the machine is very affordable. And if you look at the cost of operation of the machine, it's very affordable. Long term, the day you decide to put it back and buy a new machine, the value of it is much, much higher. And then if you put it into the field and try and operate the machine, it's easy to operate. And then the access to a dealer network that can service you, the access to part, it's really, really an affordable machine that has ease of operation to start your business and to keep you in business and to make you profitable as a farmer.
Is that part, when you say ease of operation, does that mean that it's got minimal technology? Because one of the key things nowadays with any particular vehicle, a lot of the expense goes into that technology, isn't it?
So Tony, in terms of that request and in terms of technology, so what I need in that space is peace of mind. If I get onto that machine, it's like my old faithful little Bucky. If I need it to start, I need it to start. So it's very important that segment of the market require that comfort. I need to have that peace of mind that when I start working with this unit, I will be able to complete my task. Of course, like Patrick shared earlier, we talk about cost of operation, we talk about that initial input cost to make sure that I get through the season, as well as make the margins at the back end of that. Now, what we've seen on this on the particular 6B as well, there's two levels of unit that's available. So there is a more advanced technology unit, but then there's also a less advanced one for the guy that really don't need that additional technology there. But it's not where it ends. If there is a commercial customer at the end that require, let's say in the precision space where we heard a lot of the mentioning earlier today as well, I can install guidance on this unit. So we've got that platform, it's pretty open, to make sure that I can help from the livestock farmer all the way through to the commercial farmer that want to use this in guidance.
Why does a commercial farmer have a mid-spec tractor on his farm? Why should he have one, Patrick?
There's number of activities on the farm that you do, of which it's the same across. It depends on the size. The variation is only the size. So for example, if the commercial farmer has to transport, say for example, some bales, he will need transport. This is a good machine for transportation. If you need to load some stuff, some bales and everything, for example, loading, there's an attachment, the loader attachment that's available for this machine. You can load your stuff. And then, like pulling your sprayers, you need to pull sprayers for short areas, then you have the machine to do all that. So it fits across commercial, mid-sized farmers and small-scale farmers.
And Kubyana, am I correct to say this particular tractor has been very popular worldwide and also throughout the continent at the moment?
100%, Tony. And due to the simplicity and the brilliance of this unit, we've seen customers reaching out from different segments of the farming community. Interesting enough, we've seen a lot of our current John Deere customers that look at this unit and say, you know what, I was not really able to utilize the high-spec technology. So I've kept my older unit for years and years and years, just for the examples that Patrick shared earlier, very, very well stated there as well, Pat. But now he can be the owner, proud owner of a 6B in that category where we don't need all that high-spec technology.
And it's a powerful machine, Patrick, strong enough?
Yes, that's strong enough. And you know, it comes with a John Deere warranty, backed up by a strong dealer network. And if you look at the base machine, for example, the base machine that you buy from John Deere on the 6B model will come with radial tires. And we all know, our test has proven that the radial tire performs better than any other tire because there's less soil compaction when you use the radial tires. And they last actually longer than the normal tires, the other tires that's in the market. So actually, it's a tool also to make you profitable on your application because there's less compaction on your field. You've got long life on your tires. So it's a win-win. So it's designed like that base.
All right, Kubyana, Patrick, you've convinced me. I'm going to go get myself a 6B.
Tony, with our current dealer network out there, with our parts distribution network, with us as John Deere and your 6B, perfect simplicity, we're ready to serve.
Fantastic stuff. Thank you, gentlemen, for taking us through this mid-spec tractor that's offered by John Deere. Well, that's it for this episode of Tech Terrain. Thank you so much for joining us. And make sure you go onto our website for loads and loads of bonus material. Make sure you join us next time because we'll be talking about technology. We'll be talking about mechanization on the African continent and also skills development. Make sure you're with us because we'll also be looking at the brand new John Deere 8R. See you next time.